I will turn it over to Jen. So thank you all.
All right. Hello. Thank you so much to all of you for being here. It's really neat to see some familiar faces and names, and also to see some new faces and names. If I haven't met you yet, hello. My name is Jen Manley, and the thing that you need to know about me is that as a teacher, one of my core beliefs is that kids deserve to do big, meaningful work. And I believe that as computer science teachers, we are equipped with a content and a special type of course in that when students learn how to code and they learn how, you know, to create with code, we empower them to do that big, meaningful work now. And that's something that sets us apart from a lot of other disciplines and something that's really cool to be able to share with our students. I teach high school computer science right now at Paint Branch High School in Montgomery County, Maryland, and I also teach at the University of Maryland. So I'm in this kind of hybrid program called Terrapin Teachers. And then the other thing that you should know is that I am a certified Scrum Master, which is a kind of silly sounding word, but basically means that I was certified to use Scrum, which is a project management tool that we're going to talk about a little bit today. And while most people who are Scrum Masters are using it within business, what I think you'll find is that Agile project management, of which Scrum is sort of a subset, is a unique way for us to offer students the opportunity to do this big, collaborative, meaningful group work now. So I'll go ahead and move on. Okay, so before we get started, I always love to provide resources. So if you need a nice little Agile toolkit, I'm going to drop it in the chat. This toolkit is there for you to use. There's, I think, 10 different resources in there for you to be able to apply what we've done today in your classroom or your school or your district immediately. So be sure to check that out. And we're going to go ahead and get started by watching this video. And as you're watching this video, I want you to think about, what does this remind you of in education? Okay, so we're gonna watch this video. Maybe you've seen it before. It's Lucy in the Candy Factory. But as you're watching it, I want us to watch it with this lens of how does this remind us of education? All right, I'm gonna mute myself so that there's no background noise.
Department.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, the candy will pass by on this conveyor belt and continue into the next room where the girls will pack it. Now, your job is to take each piece of candy and wrap it in one of these papers and then put it back on the belt. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll! Let her roll! Well, wait here. Somebody's asleep at the switch.
What are you doing up here? I thought you were downstairs boxing chocolates.
Oh, they kicked me out of there fast.
Why? I kept pinching them to see what kind they were. This is the fourth department I've been in.
Oh, I didn't do so well either.
No. All right, girls. Now, this is your last chance. If one piece of candy gets past you and into the packing room unwrapped, you're fired.
Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll!
Oh, this is easier.
Yeah, we can handle this, okay?
I think we're fighting a losing game.
doing splendidly. Speed it up a little!
All right, so we're gonna head over to Jamboard with that video in mind, and I'll go ahead and drop the link in as well into the chat. We're gonna head over to Jamboard, and if you haven't used Jamboard before, just give it a minute to load. All right. So if you haven't used Jamboard before, Jamboard is one of my favorite collaborative tools because it's so easy to share with students. It's got this very simplified toolbar, which I think is awesome in the age of distance learning. But what you're going to do is go ahead and add a sticky note with your thoughts for each side. So you just pull it up and then click save, and it'll populate a sticky note and you can move it around the way you want it to. But I'd love to know your thoughts, thinking about that Candy Factory video, what were some pain points that you noticed in the way that they were doing work? So what were some pain points of that way of working? And then on the other side, what might that resemble in education? All right, so I see some really good pain points. Yeah, there was too much work. There weren't processes or procedures in order. Oh, 8 classes this year. Yes, I when I taught middle school, I had 4 different preps and most of them didn't have curriculum. I felt like that a lot of the time. Yes, definitely. Resembles teachers trying to manage everything with little or no support. Yeah, definitely. Yes, preparing students for only the slow motion tasks. That's a great notice, right? The speed kept increasing until it was impossible to do. Oh yeah, I like this point too. One of the pain points was miscommunication between the supervisor and the team. There was no training, right? Which is both. That's a pain point, and it also resembles sometimes in school. One of the things I thought of is I think about the students who get behind on something and then they're just trying for the rest of the quarter and sometimes the rest of the year, if we don't catch it, to just catch up, right? And they might be shoving that candy into their mouth, they're making do enough, but they're totally lost on what's going on. All right, we're gonna go ahead and go to the next jam. So you can join me on the next jam by clicking this little right arrow. And with this one, what I want you to do is grab the marker tool or the pen tool. You can choose whichever thickness you want. And you're going to use the green and red colors. And I want you to think about the Candy Factory video we just watched and whether you think the Candy Factory situation places a high using a green mark or a low using a red mark priority on each of these 21st century skills that we love to talk about in education. So for example, If you thought that it was a high creativity task, you'd put a little mark on creativity in green. So I see a lot of red. And I definitely agree. I think that especially how this task was executed, right? We don't see a lot of creativity or collaboration or communication or critical thinking. I mean, there was a little bit of critical thinking when there was so much candy coming off and they needed to, yes, they did try to creatively solve the problem, right? All the candy was coming out and they were like, we got to do something about it. And they ate all the candy at once. Yes, I would agree. That was probably the most creative and, critically thought out part of the whole operation, right? How do we get rid of our problem? All right, so we're going to watch a second video and then we'll come back to the Jamboard. And before we get into it, I'm wondering, go ahead and add in the chat, we've got creativity, collaboration, communication, and critical thinking. Why are those skills important in general in education? And why do you think they're even more important in computer science education? You can just drop it in the chat. Definitely, people need those skills no matter what they're doing. Ooh, yeah, definitely. They're hard to test for mastery. Yep. And I think sometimes because they're hard to assess for mastery, sometimes people shy away from doing them because we're so focused on the standards, which are a little bit easier to test. Right, in terms of mastery. Yes, CS involves a ton of problem solving and very few problems can be done alone. Or you can do a bigger scale problem with other people, right? You might be able to do coding alone, but in order to really do big work, we have to work in teams. Yes, world and problems are constantly changing. Computing problems are highly complex. Yes, definitely, yeah. You need all four C's in CS, maybe even more so than any other subject, if we're being honest. Okay, so we're going to watch another video, and this one is a different team. This is a team at IDEO, and you may have heard of IDEO before. They're kind of famous for the shopping cart video. They have to redesign a shopping cart. But in this one, I want you to think about what is Agile-y about this team? So some of you maybe have never heard of Agile before, but you know what the word Agile means in terms of just a regular dictionary definition. So based on whatever you know about Agile, as we're watching this video, I want you to think about what is Agile-y about this particular team.
I'm JB Brown, the Nordstrom Innovation Lab Manager, and this is the lab. We work on 1 week experiments. Somebody will have an idea and we'll find a way to figure out how to prove if the idea is going to work. And this week, the Innovation Lab is going to be building an iPad app with customer feedback as we go through the week. We wanted to work in the store to make sure that we were getting customer feedback as we worked so that we were never working on anything that wasn't valued by the customer and only doing things that are delivering value. So we'll be building a feature and testing it until we get to the point where we have something that's good enough that we can just leave the iPad app behind and have this new thing that customers can use. This is the world's first flash build. It's a flash mob where a software team shows up and builds an application in a surprise location. This is the Nordstrom Innovation Lab, and we're at the flagship store in downtown Seattle. Right now, the team is just setting up their equipment to get started. We're going to build an iPad app that helps customers pick the best pair of sunglasses for them. We really don't know what the features are yet. We're going to use customer feedback as we go along throughout the day and the rest of the week in order to build the best thing.
So the next thing we're going to do is a user story map. So we're going to sit here and together outline all the steps the customer would take, and actually even beforehand, how they buy sunglasses. Like, what are the different things that they might do and how that process might change if we have this application. And we'll actually dig into what we have to build in order to support that process.
So now that we've done a card mapping, we're going to do a paper prototype, and this is something that we commonly do in the innovation lab. It's a great way to show what we'd like to do in a rough prototype that we can easily throw out, change, alter, based on feedback from the customers. I'll continue building individual paper slides, and our user experience specialist at Mattel will bring the prototype to a customer and say, okay, I have this app, and this is a paper version. I'd like you to kind of use it like you would normally use an app, and you can press things, interact with them, and then she'll change out the pages based on how the customer uses it. So it's a similar experience to the iPad, only an analog version.
So it's day two, and we have our first working prototype of this app. And how it works is I take my first pair of sunglasses, put it on, take a picture, all right, and then I want to compare it to this other pair I've got right here. Put these on, take another picture. I can just hold these up like this and see which one I like better.
Well, Tal and Kim have been talking to people and doing paper prototypes. We've been coding, building an iPad. We take a stab at something. We look at the paper prototypes that Kim put together. We might take one at a time. Usually we come to the board and we grab the most important feature and we start implementing it. The really cool thing with this flash build is that we have actual real customers. Just today we delivered 4 or 5 different separate features, and I deliver it, swap the iPad with Tel. She'd go and talk to a customer, and 10 minutes later I had feedback from real customers about this thing that I delivered, and it changed how we did the next thing.
All right, so it looks like it's totally fine. I've loved watching these come up as it's been happening. So just want to go over what's already in the chat. And if you haven't added your ideas, what is Agile about this team? So we've got 1 week increments, they're iterative, customer value is a priority, iterative testing and optimization, getting customer feedback, created stories, and what to do to support those stories, prioritize features, focusing on one idea at a time. Any other things that come up for how this team might be Agile-y? For those of you who haven't had the chance to chime in yet. Yeah, fast and organized way to tackle a big problem. The speed is definitely something that is indicative of an agile team, right? Quick, but organized and efficient. Consistently, are constantly seeking and using feedback. Yes, awesome. All right. So we're gonna head back to the Jamboard one more time. And instead of adding our thoughts for, we're gonna go to number 4, page 4. Oh, good, so people were on the Jamboard already, even better. Focusing on another idea at a time, breaking the problem into smaller pieces. And then let's look at this 21st century skills grid again. And this time, thinking about the team at IDEO, do you think they placed a high using green or low value on each of these 4 skills? And I'll drop the Jamboard link in the chat again in case you closed out of it. All right, so we've got lots of green check marks as compared to our lots of red check marks when we thought about the candy factory. And I guess I'll just throw it out there in the chat. Which one of these do you think is the most important in IDEO's process: creativity, collaboration, communication, critical thinking. You had to pick one. I see communication in the chat. One of the things that's so cool about Agile, and we'll get into this in a second, is that communication is not just between the team, right? There's constant communication between, yes, there we go, prioritize work, communicate feedback from customers, and decide who's doing what. So it's constant communication. Yep, critical thinking. Critical thinking is definitely important, because with Agile, you have to be always open to pivoting, right? So you're always thinking about what you're doing and being open to changing course, not mid-sprint, but changing course occasionally if it necessitates it after working with customers. Yep. Have to be creative. And of course, you have to be collaborative, right? Agile, and we're going to talk more about this, is a team effort. Okay. Oh, always does this to me. All right, so now that we've seen what Agile is in action, let's talk a little bit about just recapping what it is. So Agile is a subset of project management frameworks. You may have heard of Scrum. Scrum is a version of Agile, but Agile is basically an umbrella, okay? It's from industry, not education. And some of the big focuses are on being iterative and incremental, so constantly evaluating your project and your process, and building upon delivered products, which is really cool to use in education. Multiple and frequent feedback. So you're constantly getting feedback from your team, from yourself, and from your customers, and using that feedback in an ongoing way in order to continue to improve your product. And I think the thing that distinguishes Agile from the way that we traditionally do group work in our classroom is that the focus is on delivering a shippable product. So when this project management framework comes from industry, right, our product is only useful if we can sell it. If it's not shippable, if it's not ready to be delivered to the customer, then it's of no use to us. And so with Agile in education, and you'll see this, our focus is on these potentially shippable increments so that we can move things to done. We can have components of our project that are finished and considered done on their own. So there's a whole group of people who have focused on Agile in education and who are practicing Agile in education all over the world. And with Agile in education, one of the things that we use to guide how we're using Agile in our classroom is this. It's called the Agile in Education Compass, and it's focused on the sort of core components. So in your classroom, how are you shifting from being prescriptive to being iterative? How are you shifting from the content to focusing on your culture in your classroom? How are we shifting from evaluation to having visible feedback and reflection, which is going to give more information back to the students rather than just giving them a grade necessarily. Shifting from a culture of control to one of trust, so giving up some of your control so that your students have control. And finally, shifting from competition to collaboration. So how are we giving students the ability and empowering our students to collaborate with each other rather than compete? I'm going to show you how Agile can work in the classroom, but before we get into it, a few reasons why I love to use Agile in the classroom, and I've been using Agile now for 4 years in my classroom at both the high school, middle school, and college level. And what I found is that at every level, Agile increases buy-in, contribution, and ownership for every student. Students feel like their work is theirs, right? They have this sense of ownership over it. Students get more done because they learn how to focus on what is most important first, which is something that human beings struggle with. Humans struggle with doing the work that's most important first, right? We like to check things off the list. And so if we can teach our students to do the most important work first, they get more done. It shifts your classroom from student-centered to student-led. So rather than it just being about your students doing the work, your students are really taking ownership and leading their own learning, which is really great as we try to build lifelong learners, who are going to be successful in their learning pursuits throughout their entire lives. Of course, it brings in collaboration, creativity, critical thinking, and communication. And the reason I really like it, especially as a CS teacher, I started using it when I taught middle school and I had 240 students a semester. And the thing that I loved about it is that instead of looking at 200 different CS projects, Agile made it easy for me to assess learning, and it also made it easy for me to monitor multiple projects at one time. So I think that Agile, not just because it's an industry-specific tool, but because of what it does for CS teachers, is a wonderful fit in the CS classroom. All right, so before we get into it, I think it's really important to share this quote. I share it every time I talk about Agile. Agile is not a prescribed methodology. It's a set of values and principles that represents a better way of organizing work and getting people to work together. So pick and choose which parts of the methodology work for your team. So I'm gonna share with you what Agile in education looks like for me and for other people that I've worked with. But it's really important that you know that Agile in education does not mean you have to implement everything we talk about at one time. Okay, our goal is to shift from less Agile to more Agile. Agile in the classroom exists on a spectrum. There are teachers using elements of Agile and elements of Scrum and all of these things in their classrooms all over the world. Agile is a spectrum, and it is okay to iteratively grow Agile in your classroom. So you might find, as we talk through this, that the only thing that realistically you could implement in your classroom would be some form of retrospective. Implementing that form of retrospective is a win, right? So thinking about, instead of being discouraged, if you're like, this is too much, I could never do it, looking at it as, what pieces could I take, iterate on, and make fit for me and my students? All right. How many of you have felt at some point in your career that group work is the worst? Anybody? You can give me a thumb up or the little check mark in the participants window, yes or no, if you've ever felt that way. Or in the chat. Yeah, kids don't like it. Why don't kids like it? Mm-hmm. One person ends up doing all of the work. It's not evenly distributed. Yeah. So I'm sure, yeah, definitely unmute yourself if you'd like to speak. Thanks, Michelle. Hard to grade effort, difficult to assess. Concerned about the grade, the rest take it easy, peer pressure, some may dominate. Yeah, so I've experienced all of those things. And what I'd like to offer, right, so we've maybe seen this meme before, right? There's always the one guy who does everything, or kid who does everything, it's not always guy. There's always one person who does most of the work. There's always one person who does very little. And then there's the kids in the middle who are trying to keep up and do their part, right? But I'd like to offer that maybe the reason that group work is like this is not because of the students, but rather because of the model, right? The way that we teach kids to do group work doesn't necessarily align with how they'll do group work in the real world. A lot of times in classes, we like to assign kids roles. And the reality is that some of those roles are just not as interesting as the others, right? Materials manager is one that always comes up for me, right? What is the materials manager's job? What does that job look like? I hate that role too, Vicky. Tell us why you hate it. The materials manager doesn't have any buy-in to the project. Their job is to get the materials and to make sure they're put away. They're not, yes, exactly, Vicky. They're not creating anything. They're not adding any value in their role to the group project, right? And the reality is that when kids get to the real world, you know, I don't know how many teams you've worked on in your career as a teacher outside of being a teacher, but people who are seen as excellent are not just people who work in the silo of what their role is, right? They're people who are willing to go above and beyond or outside the scope of their defined role to do what's best for the team. And so giving kids roles not only sets them up to be in this place where one kid does most of the work and some kids don't do any, but it also doesn't really mirror what they'll see when they get into the real world. All right, so we know, and we've all talked about this in the chat already, in order for kids to do big projects, they need to collaborate, right? The world values collaboration, large-scale projects help them to build tenacity, and ultimately they can accomplish more if they're working in a team. Okay, so here's what this could look like. Here's what, you know, and I don't know how many of you are in physical classrooms right now. I am not, we've been virtual all year, but here's what it would look like potentially in a physical classroom, right? So here's a Scrum board. This is actually from my classroom. This is also from my classroom where they did it on big whiteboard. Here's another classroom where they were working on, they were using Agile to manage the yearbook. I love using manila folders when we're in person because it's easy to store when you have 8 different classes of kids that you're trying to manage materials for. But in person, it looks like this. It looks like Scrum boards or Kanban boards that kids can actually move post-its around on. But we're virtual. And you might even prefer to do things virtually, even when you're not, you know, even when we're not asynchronous, even when we're in person, you may prefer to do things virtually. So these two, the slides presentation and then the Jamboard are both located in that Agile toolkit that we shared at the beginning. So you can use Jamboard for it. You can use Google Slides. Or you could use Trello, which if you've never used Trello before, Trello is a wonderful way of managing work, not just for students, but for you too. Lots of ways to customize. And as a teacher, you can actually manage, or you can be added onto every group's Trello. And so it's really easy for you to see where kids are all in one place. Other great tools and options as we get into talking about it, Jamboard, Trello, Miro. I would suggest for high school only, not elementary or middle. Miro is pretty advanced, but if your kids are quick to pick up on things, Miro has a lot of great functionality. Mural is another one that's been suggested to me. That one costs some money, so depending on if you have a budget. And then Google Slides. And Google Slides, again, is really nice because you could have every group's Scrum board in the same Google Slides presentations, you could monitor them all at once while kids were working in breakout rooms. So Slides might be a good one to look at too. Okay, so the question that I always get from teachers is, what does Scrum stand for? So I keep saying Scrum board. And the answer is that it doesn't stand for anything because it wasn't created by educators. Scrum actually comes from rugby, and I've never played rugby or watched rugby, but my understanding is that the scrum is at the very beginning of the game and both teams are trying to get the ball. And so they work as a whole team to get the ball in their possession. Fun fact. Scrum, like I said, Agile is the umbrella. Scrum is a tool, an Agile tool, and it helps our students to manage their work by themselves, collaboratively, and to find meaning in our content, and also to meet the standards in lots of different curricula. So we can use it for CS, they can also use it in other classes too. Okay, so here's the process that I follow in my classroom and that most Agile educators follow. follow, so general process. The first thing that students are going to do is they're going to break down all of the work they need to do into a product backlog. And the product backlog is made up of what we call potentially shippable increments. So those are things that could be considered done on their own. From there, once they've planned out their whole project or all of their learning, they then go into sprint planning. And in sprint planning, they decide how much of that product backlog they can accomplish in a given period of time. In my class, that's typically 1 to 2 weeks, but it might vary depending on how often you see your students. So they break that down, right? They prioritize their product backlog, they decide how much they can accomplish, and then they further break down those product backlog items into actionable tasks. And we'll talk more about what that means in a second here. Once they've broken down their sprint, which is the set period of time they're going to work, into these actionable tasks, they get to work. So they focus on only those tasks for, you know, 1 week or 2 weeks, however long your sprint is. Every day, they're going to hold a daily scrum meeting or a daily meeting, whatever you want to call it, and they'll check in on their process and their product as a team, and everybody will be able to share out. At the end of each sprint, we hold two meetings, a sprint review and a sprint retrospective. The review is students talking about their product. So what did they actually deliver in that set period of time? The retrospective is where they're going to talk about their process. So as a team, what did they do well? What could they do differently? And what actionable commitments can they make as they go into their next block of work? And then finally, at the end of every sprint, we have a potentially releasable product increment. So students have stuff that they finish that they can consider done on its own. I'm gonna pause for a second. Vicky says we used manila folders and post-its last year on our Lego robots projects. Constantly lost post-its, plans with you virtually. Yeah, post-its. I like the manila folders because usually they stay put, but you gotta get the sticky post-its. I also understand kids losing them, especially younger kids. Sixth graders that I used to work with lost post-its all the time. It's good to take a picture of it or to transition to virtual. Great thought. Okay, so that's a big thing to show kids. Yeah, fifth grade. This graphic is a lot to show kids. So what I show kids is this, right? They're gonna build their backlog, they're gonna order it, they'll commit to what they're gonna accomplish, they'll task out those commitments. So it's in these actionable tasks. Then they'll take ownership of what they're going to work on. They'll get things done. They'll have a daily scrum meeting every day, and then they'll repeat the process over again. So this is my favorite graphic to use. All right, so we're gonna talk about each of these steps a little bit more in depth. And before we get into it, I wanna make sure there's a few things to keep in mind. The first is the definition of done. So what does done look like? Really important to remember as we're working with students. The second thing is our goal is to deliver the highest quality product in the shortest amount of time. So efficiency, but also delivering a high quality product. So we're teaching students how to balance those things. We want to have rapid and repeated inspection of our product. Our priorities are set by the client. So in this case, you, the teacher, you are the client, right? What students need to accomplish, it might be in a rubric, right? It might be in the directions, the assignment that you gave them. It could be your standards. There are teachers who manage their entire school year using Agile and have students, you know, take different standards and figure out how they're going to master each of them. And then the last thing is that shorter sprints are ideal for project-based learning. So it might be tempting to say, oh, kids need 3 weeks for each sprint. But actually, when we cut down on that time, we create this sense of urgency for kids to get more done. This is just a calendar of what this looks like in my classroom. So product backlog is about a half to one class. Sprint backlog, half to one class. A sprint is 3 to 6 class periods. And then it's broken down that way. So if you want this later, you can see sort of my timetable of what it looks like in my class. All right, so the first thing students are going to do is build and order their product backlog. Their goal is to identify what we call potentially shippable product increments, which are things that can be considered done on their own. If you're using a board, Trello or otherwise, each of those potentially shippable products is going to get its own post-it or card. And then the last part of this step is that students should order that backlog by what's most important. So by the end, they'll have all of the things that need to be accomplished for a particular project or learning increment, and they're going to order it in terms of priority. Again, that focus on doing the most important work first. The next thing they do is commit to a sprint. So they're gonna figure out, okay, we have 3 to 6 class periods to work. Which of these things from our backlog can we accomplish in 3 to 6 class periods? So we have to have some conversations about how much time they actually have, right? If they're working on things individually and coming back together as a team, then they actually have more time than 3 to 6 class periods, right? Because each student is working intently for that time. So they'll pull things from their product backlog and they'll put it into their sprint backlog to say, yes, we commit to doing these things. They then will complete their sprint backlog by breaking down each of those product backlog items into actionable tasks. I tell students that an actionable task is something that can be completed in 1 class period or less. So we add those task cards to the sprint backlog, and typically, if you saw my picture back here, wow, I went way back. I use different colors, right? So they used yellow here, but they also had purple post-its, right? So having separate colors for each of those things is really helpful to help students visualize the size of what they're looking at. Then we get into the sprint itself. So the first thing students need to do is take ownership. Once all of the task cards are written, so everything they need to get done, students need to take ownership of what they're going to work on first. And this is so key. The biggest part of Agile is that it gives the ownership back to the students. And so it's really important that when we're asking students which tasks they'd like to own, we're allowing them to make those choices. So some tasks might be individual tasks, others might be things the whole team needs to decide on, could be a pair task if you're doing some coding and you have some pair programming activities. But again, we're gonna make it so that students are taking ownership of the tasks that they're going to work on first. The most important thing about, well, not most, there's a lot of important things, but one very important thing about Agile is that we acknowledge that we need to focus on one task at a time until completion, because multitasking is a myth. And human beings love to multitask, but research shows that with every task we add, we decrease our productivity by about 20% because task switching takes that much cognitive demand, right, or cognitive load. So our goal here is students are going to own which tasks they're going to work on first, and they're going to work on one task at a time until completion. Each day, they're gonna have this daily scrum meeting. I typically do it at the beginning of class. I think it's a nice way to check in and start their workday. And the 3 questions they're gonna answer is, what did you do last class? What will you work on today? And what blockers are in your way? They're gonna have these conversations as a team. Each student will share out, and it creates this level of accountability so that every student is accountable to their team for accomplishing the work. At the end of a sprint, like I mentioned, we have 2 meetings. The first meeting is the retrospective, which is where we're gonna talk about our process. So what worked well, what could be improved, and what can we commit to doing in the next sprint? The team is going to make some actionable commitments. Like I said earlier, this is one of the easiest ways to incorporate Agile into your classroom, and you can literally do it the next time you meet with students through a start, stop, continue. So you can ask your students for feedback on what's working in your class, so that'd be continue, what you need to start doing in your class, so be start, and what's not working in your class, what do you need to stop? There's a template for running start, stop, continue in that Agile toolkit that you have access to. The other meeting is the sprint review. The sprint review is where they're going to share out about their product. So what did they create? Right? What did their team complete in the last sprint? Which product backlog items are considered done? What did we finish? And which didn't we finish? What should, you know, go at the top of our lot of our sprint backlog, or sorry, our sprint backlog as we start our next sprint. And then after we finish this block of work, is there anything we didn't think of that we now need to add to our product backlog, right? Did stuff come up that we need to add so that we can accomplish it moving forward? I also think it's really powerful to use Agile sometimes for individual students. So with a team, you're going to use a board to manage it. But right now, especially, lots of our students are struggling because they don't have the executive functioning skills to manage all of their work remotely, right? They see you for part of the week, but the other part of the week, they're supposed to be doing their work on their own. So we can use a version of Agile for individual students. And this tracker is in your toolkit as well. The thing that's really helpful about this is we're asking students to think about what tasks do you have to do? How much time do you think they should, each of those tasks should take you? And then go ahead and prioritize, right? What's the most important thing, next most important, et cetera? And we ask them to work on one thing at a time. The version, there's actually, I think, three versions of this in your toolkit. This version and all the others are editable PDFs. You actually can assign them out. Kids can open them on their computer and then edit the PDF and send it back to you. Using Agile with individual students is really helpful for students who struggle to stay on task or students with attention disorders. I've had a lot of success using this type of tracker with students as they work on long-term projects for their CS classes. All right, this is really cool. I'd like to use some of it. How do I assess it? So before I give my thoughts, any thoughts in the chat or share out, how might you assess while using Agile? For those of you who have used it, how have you assessed? Ooh, that's cool. Yeah, a review by industry professional would be really cool. I love that. Yes. Yep. You haven't used it, but imagine it focuses on the process. Yep. So focusing on the process. Yeah, Tina, the sticky notes are definitely a way to assess what students have completed. Yeah. So one of the things I do is I have students write their name on whichever sticky notes they take, so I know who's done what work, right? Yeah, retrospective is a wonderful place to assess because you get a lot of information about their process and about their product. Yeah, self-assessment and peer assessment, huge. Yeah, the product you can assess. The product you can use your rubric to assess like you normally would. There are teachers who we'll still give the traditional quizzes to assess the standards after the fact, right? And then they also grade reflections. They have students write reflections. They have students do some self-assessment and peer assessment. Definitely you can do peer review as well. So there's lots of ways to assess it. And the real takeaway from this slide is that there's actually not one answer, right? Because there's different things that work for different people. In my classroom, I do a lot of self-reflection. I also use the retrospectives and the reviews as ways to assess. And then I assess the product against a rubric. So that's several different points where I can accurately assess how students are doing, but it might vary for your classroom and that's totally normal. It also might vary based on what your district or your school expects. So I know a lot of people who use Agile and then, like I said, they use traditional quizzes to assess whether or not the students have met the standards that they were intending to have them meet through the process. All right, and so you've heard a lot. An hour is not a whole lot of time. And if you wanna talk more about this, I'll give you my contact information at the end as well. But after watching and thinking about it and experiencing what you experienced, why might Agile be a good fit for your classroom or your students or your district? What are some things that are positive? Ooh, yes. Many of your kids are ELL and you want to build collaboration to build language. Yeah, so Tina, that's a great point. And one thing that's really positive about Agile is its authentic collaboration, which I have been told and read is a really positive way to build in language practice for students. Yep, they accomplish more. Yeah, additional benefits of practicing self-direction and planning skills. Yep, teamwork. Yeah, lots of student choice built in, which is really important too. So here's a few of the things that I thought of. It takes us from student-led, or it creates a student-led classroom with you as the facilitator, which helps make planning a little bit easier too. Also allows for student-led assessment through self and peer assessment. You can assess students on their contributions to a project rather than just a group project where you're not really sure who did what. It teaches students to chunk larger projects and helps them to manage their workload, which, like I said, all of our students need support with. I'm seeing that with high school seniors. And so I'm certain that you're probably seeing it with younger students as well. Builds communication, collaboration, creativity, all of that. Teaches students to spend their time on the tasks that are most valuable, not those that are the easiest. And of course, it's real-world application, right? This Agile is an industry tool. So when you bring Agile into the classroom, it not only builds all of these things, but we're actually preparing students for entering a career in software, if that's what they choose to do. And not just software, right? There, in my area, a major hospital system uses Agile to manage all of their work, right? Not just the software work, but the entire hospital system is using Agile. All right, so I have shared a lot and we have about 3 minutes left. And so I'm wondering if there are any questions or thoughts before we go for the night. Yes, Tina, there are more trainings. So I actually do like shorter and longer workshops. So reach out to me and there's actually something big coming in a couple of months. But yes, there are lots of people who will do trainings on Agile in education. Yeah. Thank you all so much for being here. Like I said, I'll put my email in the chat as well. I accidentally just sent it to Michelle. Hold up. Thank you so much for being here. You all were great and for participating with me and for giving up some time before you go on winter break. I really appreciate it. Definitely reach out if I can help with anything else.
Thank you so much, Jen. This was a fabulous webinar. There goes my video. Just a couple of things. If you're not already a member of the CS for All Teachers, please join us. Free. It's a free membership. Just go to csforallteachers.org and you can sign up in the upper right-hand corner. We are taking a break from our live events for the holidays, but we do have a lot of great webinars coming up in the works in January and February. In the meantime, check out our six core discussion groups listed here, linked on the screen. And you do need to be a member to join those. But again, it's a free membership. Also, we are active on Twitter. If you didn't know, join us there. And thank you all. Happy holidays. And we hope to see you online. Thank you.